Hello everyone, I'm Sabina, one of the graduating students of MA Data Visualisation 2020 and one of the hosts for today. Welcome to the MA Data Visualisation event, Convergence, Data Design Research. This is an opportunity for us, the MA Data Visualisation 2020 graduates, to come together from across the globe and celebrate our research, work and practice with you. While many of us have been far apart for the last 3 months, in the UK, China, or Italy, for example, we have found sites of convergence through our parallel inquiries into data and visualization. We'd like to share with you today video presentations of our final major projects, followed by a short Q&A. This is an insight into our design research process and the tangible and digital outcomes we have developed in response to this. Throughout these projects, we have explored the context of data and visualization practices and sought to test the boundaries of the discipline of data visualization and information design. You can explore graduating students' work after this event by visiting our graduate showcase, which we have uploaded in the chat. Before we start, however, there are a few house rules. This event is recorded and will be made public on the LCC YouTube channel afterwards. By attending a live event, guests agree to their contributions being captured and used for this purpose. We encourage you to ask your questions into the Q&A and we will get to them during the designated Q&A part of the event. Our community guidelines, which we expect all participants in virtual events to abide by, both presenters and attendees, have been posted in the chat. Share your thoughts on the showcase and this event across social media. You can find us on Instagram at madataviz_LCC. So, without further ado, I will introduce the first video presentation with the theme Digital Textures by Mengfan, Monica, Helen, Edith, and Cliff. We hope you enjoy the projects as much as we have. Please write down any questions you might have about the students' work in the Q&A window, which you will find at the bottom of the screen. Let's start the first video.
In popular culture, we are arguably surrounded by images of our possible, or probable, future relationship with technology. Images like this can be seen to reflect our hopes and aspirations, but also our fears and anxiety about the impact rapid changes in our relationship with technology might have. In the five projects we would like to share with you here, we have all considered shifts and changes to our communities, relationships, ways of working and living, and their impacts. We want to explore how design and data visualization, as well as visual responses to data and other sources of insight and understanding, can help foster consideration and debate around these shifts. To articulate, and perhaps moderate, our shared hopes, fears and concerns. Ming Fan's project focuses on a celebration of local history and culture. She designed Fragmented Elephant as an online data sharing platform and a live memorial for Elephant and Castle Shopping Center. This site aims to be a meeting place for all those involved in the Elephant and Castle Regeneration Program. Ming Fan has defined four key groups within her research: Transformer, Trader, Community, Newcomer. Tagged as Opportunity Area in the London Plan, Elephant and Castle, previously a South London community with long history and strong local culture, is now experiencing a 15-year regeneration program. In this project, Ming Fan has built a platform that documents and celebrates the local culture of Elephant and Castle. Her intention is that it acts as a means for others to share their sentiments and their memories. The site also addresses the ethical dimension of data sharing and gathering online, foregrounding considerations about how participants' information will be shared and maintained. In the future, Ming Fan intends that this online intervention might be developed into a street-based installation to further support participation and address issues of inequality and data literacy.
Audio Jungle.
Monica's project focuses on portrait rights online. The outcome of her research into this topic is a concept for an app which poses a series of questions about users' level of engagement with issues of privacy and image rights online. In a playful response, the app generates a tailor-made data filter according to users' concerns and levels of engagement. Color, shape, and form can be adapted to signify the attitudes of users to this issue. The intention here is that outcome brings this issue to life for the user, and prompts them to reflect on the various means of protecting privacy online. This filter will also be able to use in Instagram and InStory in the coming future. Helen's project outcome is a speculative set of appliances including smart bed, smart radiator and smart TV for the Internet of Things enabled home in 2050. She aims to offer a critique of the implementation of Internet of Things and discuss its threat of data surveillance. This interactive website is intended to promote and attract people purchase the smart appliances. The diagram explains how smart home users' data might be generated, aggregated and sorted in order to define correct behaviors and control users' choices. The distinctive features of the appliances are defined in these visualizations. Their form changes based on data about the user's previous behaviors, and in doing so, limits their ability to choose different behaviors in the present or future. The visualization adopted Edward Tufte's data ink principle, which is minimizing the graph architecture, as well as applying a modernist aesthetic. This is intended to contrast with the more evocative presentation of the appliances themselves. The intention of Cliff's project is to consider the future of the Internet of Things through a focus on smart objects. The work aims to create a design artifact which responds to some of the concepts he has engaged with during the course of his research. Using Cinema 4D, he built a smart kettle to explore how the Internet of Things might affect human-object interaction, drawing on the concept of object-oriented ontology. The smart kettle also responds to some of his hopeful and optimistic inquiry into the way in which our interactions with objects might help us engage concerns related to sustainability. The shape of the kettle is based on the data of people's daily habits of using this device. The edge of the spout is made smaller so that the water comes out in small amount, as a reminder to not overuse the water. The proposed kettle also comes with built-in sensors to generate data about the user's daily habits relating to the kettle usage, which generates an on-screen visualization and user interface to display the data and information about energy use and impact. Yamung's project explores domestic violence and its representation in China's newspapers over the last decade. Yamung used questionnaires and interviews to explore how readers understand reports about domestic violence, and use the material she gathered to visualize how interpretation of a single report can vary. Here her intention was to illuminate how our understanding of these issues can be framed and informed by context and social norms. Yamung transformed, through visualization, the participants' responses into shifting jellyfish forms and use these to consider a possible connection between interpretations and gender, education and age. Yamung also chose three Chinese newspapers from Party Press and another three from Metropolis newspaper in different regions from 2007 to 2017. She analyzed these to explore whether domestic violence is a significant news agenda item and how is portrayed in the newspapers. From this she created a web-based outcome. The first part of the website is the report feature, which includes topic, attitude, source, report genre, report format. While the second part focuses on length and features of the text as well as details of the incident reported. The audience can navigate the information through an interactive visualization, to zoom in and explore in more depth different aspects of the research.
Hello, everyone. I am Carolina, graduating student of MA Data Visualisation 2020. I'll be hosting the second part of this event. So I will now introduce our second group's presentation, curated by Sabina, Rex, Yitong, and Richa, whose theme is Social Health, Society, Culture, and Wellbeing. Remember, you can write down any questions in the Q&A window, and we'll get back to them after the last presentation. So please enjoy.
The viewpoints and perceptions of various generations are important in modern communication research. Our work acknowledges culture, well-being, and practices coinciding over youth, ensuring that a wide array of perspectives are heard and that the research is made easily accessible to the public, utilizing innovations and socio-technical approaches that are trying to shape society along with allowing for new modes of communication and new opportunities for knowledge.
The American shooting as a very serious social security issue in American society is no longer just a concern of the American people. Its popularity and extensiveness have extended to the world. Firearm suicide is slowly spreading in American society, especially among teenagers. My research for this final major project work focused on the incidence and the possible causes of gun suicide in the U.S., especially for teenagers.
Many young people experience negative emotional well-being and find it difficult to find support, yet there are cuts to funds for the child and adolescent mental health services. My project aims to increase awareness of an alternative and more accessible online counselling service, Childline, using positive user data to encourage engagement with young people aged 10 to 18.
PowerMe is an interactive tool that reflects the existence of gender stereotypes in superpower distributions from comic. My project was inspired by some gender-related inequalities in comics.
Exploring the impact of the growing practice of changing diet choices on the natural environment. Over the last few years, there has been a distinct shift in our eating habits towards vegetable-based diets, and in the number of people being identified as vegetarian or vegan. According to the UK diet trends for 2020 as well, the millennial generation is currently the most meat-free generation, counting to 13% of the population, becoming the target audience for this project.
My project focused on young people, so I hope that my project will resonate with this group of individuals and hope that they can ask questions while watching the project. The presentation of data visualization is usually a design form related to graphic design, such as posters or package. But when the data is relatively complex, it may be relatively difficult for them to understand the traditional data visualization. For the vast majority of young people who have not been exposed to data analysis, dynamic data visualization such as animation can classify this complex data, presenting different data to young audience in different transition may be better for such group of audience to understand the data.
The target audience of 10 to 18 year olds have a large online presence. I researched how Childline was using the internet to reach out to young people. I analysed Childline's social media Instagram page and noticed they rebranded with a more vibrant look. To connect with my audience, I also used data and narratives from past cases to relate with people who are experiencing similar situations. A video is also accessible through multiple devices and can be viewed from many sources, such as YouTube, which has a large audience of 10 to 14 year olds. Overall, I designed my outcome with visuals which would appeal towards all ages from 10 to 18 by using bright colours and combining 3D and 2D illustration.
First of all, we can find that there is a huge gap between male and female superheroes in popularity and distribution of superpowers. If we want to change this phenomenon, we first need to educate the audience to reduce their gender stereotypes. A teaching plan shows their steps are firstly asking students to find a gender stereotype in superpowers, and then asking them to create the superhero image they want to be. So I positioned my project as an interactive tool and following this teaching plan. I collected the names of DC and Marvel's superheroes and their superpowers from the open database and divided the superpowers into 5 categories, which allow us to more clearly understand the distribution characteristics of superpowers. Finally, I made a superpower model and compared the superpowers of top 25 female and male superheroes. The fact is that there are obvious gender differences in the distribution of superpowers.
The research methods used provide opportunities to develop and design from a creative perspective, also holding the challenge of reaching the wider audience and developing a design that is easily interpretable by them. The design of the outcome for the project is determined by the findings of the primary research methods and the analysis using secondary research. As the project is targeted at the youth, making it digital increases the probability of the idea reaching more number of people. To achieve this, I built the Key for website as an interactive dashboard that holds the scope for encouraging the audience to dig deeper into gathering knowledge for making well-informed decisions before opting for a change in their diet. The goal throughout this project has been to let people explore the information as a solution for making effective and superior choices for their diet.
And that was our second video. Now I'll introduce our third and last group, Zongyang, Bella, Ben, and myself, with the theme, "The Medium is the Message." Once again, remember to write down any questions in the Q&A window and enjoy.
Canadian philosopher Marshall McLuhan, in his book, "The Medium is the Message," pointed that when we convey information, the appropriate media selection may facilitate the audience's understanding of information more than the content. In these 4 projects, we materialize obscure data and topics using tangible medium to help people better perceive the story behind the data influencing people's behavior. In order to make the presentation be more clearer, we divided research process into 4 parts: data theory, context theory, research method, and outcome. Each project is represented by a different color: Memorial Vase by Zongyang, Kaleidoscope by Carolina, Landscape by Eero, Invisible Challenge by Ben.
The widespread use of the internet has changed the way people communicate. The record of much of our communication with the world is automatically and stored online. But what happens to this digital data when people die? This project explores the relationship between digital heritage and people who have lost their loved ones. McLuhan in 1967 pointed that the medium is more potent than the content in changing people's behavior. In this project, I use data physicalization as my core approach. Experiment with different mediums, acrylics, wood. By creating a physical body for the digital memories, let the tangible features bring sensory, handmade historical feeling into the digital formative data, encouraging people to value those data. For the outcome, the memorial vase is a highly customizable and personalized remembrance for the bereavement. Each layer of vase represents the day they chat online from the SNS platform. Duration of each conversation shaped the edge of the vase. The content of each conversation transformed into abstract pixel patterns shows in each layer. Our technology is also added to each vase. It not only allows users to see the intact eChat records but also provides a chance for them to upload their own digital images which they want to keep or show to the deceased in the future.
The Kaleidoscope project explores the topic of female genital mutilation or cutting, also called female circumcision. The practice that has affected so far at least 200 million individuals is currently recognized as a violation of human rights of women and girls, but this vision is not universally shared. The project consists of a set of garments decorated with patterns derived by data on FGMC. People can touch and wear them in order to offer a sensory experience. In fact, by realizing these garments, I aimed at creating an empathetic engagement with the user, in line with what in Feminist Data Visualization Manifesto is called embodied and effective experience. Alongside this, I designed a cognitive journey offered by the exhibition proposal, which provides the visitors with a space for discovery and conversation. Being shaped by these and other guidelines, present in Klein's and Ignazio's theory and in data humanism, presented by Giorgio Lupi, my outcome aims at representing the complexity of an issue that is heavily rooted in traditions, beliefs, and cultural dynamics. During my research, both desk-based and in-person, mainly through interviews and a survey, I could appreciate how these factors, together with many others, like the types of FGMC procedures, practitioners, times at which it is performed, consequences, legal frameworks, and most importantly, personal experiences, end up drawing a different pattern for every country, even every single person involved. A complexity that is metaphorically reflected in the very title of my project, Kaleidoscope.
The project Landscape aims to celebrate Chinese culture through contemporary fashion content. For historical reasons, the Made in China label has often been given a negative connotation in the fashion industry. Through questionnaires and interviews targeted at Chinese customer behavior, I've investigated a sense of cultural inferiority among Chinese consumers when approaching fashion products. By analyzing Chinese customer behavior, I've gained profound knowledge about Chinese consumers' attitudes towards international and domestic designer brands. In recent years, talented Chinese fashion designers have made a significant global impact and have embraced Chinese culture in their designs. Fashion is powerful and it carries culture. I would like to promote the designer brands to Chinese customers. Inspired by Giorgia Lupi's theories on data complexity and soft data, a web-based format was designed to allow the readers to receive the information with multiple layers under the specific rich content. Landscape visualizes Chinese designer brands' experiences both domestically and internationally, highlighting the brand's creative responses to Chinese culture. Landscape provides a platform for the Chinese consumers to learn about Chinese designer brands. It serves as a landscape for the Chinese fashion industry and a vision for its increased recognition and cultural value.
Invisible Challenge focuses on the impact the constant connection of via mobile devices might have, an invisible impact on the sleep patterns and habits of young adults. I collected data on the sleep patterns of young adults aged 18 to 24 through questionnaires. I organized and analyzed the data, and used data visualization as a tool to explore the challenges of the participants' use of mobile devices before bed, on their sleep quality, and find the direction of their design.
In the design development, many forms of display have been tried, such as laser printing and 3D printing to convey participants' sleep data. The outcome shown here uses data visualization as a means to highlight that this problem exists, and to stress how the ability makes a change in this area is in the hands of individuals. The role of interaction with the material, the music box and the 3D model in particular is key. It is hoped that it makes manifest this issue which is so easily overlooked, and also encourages members of the audience to spend time with the objects and reflect on the topic.
Overall, vase, garment, website, and a music box, the medium that we've chosen helped us to convey messages we want to share with the audience. Even here too, we use interactive data visualization as a medium for us to show the hidden connections of the four projects, to tell the data stories behind design outcomes.
And that was our last video. So thank you to the graduates who have presented the work, and thank everyone for being here today, for watching our presentations. Now we'll be moving on to the Q&A portion of this event. So let's start with the questions. First question, for a group social health, society, culture and well-being, I think specifically addressed to Rex, but you guys choose. So the question is, how do you make sure your sources of data are reliable, especially when it's more of a news-based subject, such as suicide or school shootings? Let's see if we get an answer otherwise. We can ask in general to the group if all right, maybe there might be some technical issues as well. So if anyone wants to answer more in general to the to how we make sure we get reliable data sources when it's a matter of sensible data. Helen?
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes.
Perfect. Yeah. Although my project is not really quoting the secondary sources data, but I think I could answer this question. I think it's about data ethics. So when we are drawing on some secondary resource, such as some open data online, maybe we could first of all check whether the organization is reliable. And also we may have to look at whether the methodology of the collecting the data, whether it is reliable. So this is what I think. Thank you.
Thanks, Ellen. Very nice. So we can move on to the next question. And this is, I think, a general one. So anyone could volunteer an answer to that. So what tools have been used to create these beautiful visualizations?
Hey, so there's been a lot of tools that people have used for 3D. Cliff used Cinema 4D, I used Blender. For illustrations, we used Adobe Illustrator, Photoshop. We used XD by Adobe. So mostly a lot of the Adobe suite we used, which we learned throughout the course.
Yeah, that was very accurate. So I hope this answered the questions. So next question, do you intend to take these projects further in some way? If so, how? Again, I think, and it's not directed to anybody in particular, so if anyone feels like answering this question for their own project.
Hi, so maybe I can answer this question because my project in this outcome is only a digital platform. So it is only designed for the online experience, but my project is focused on the elephant and castle. So it is an offline space. So for me, I think my further step for my project, and also that is also what I try to do, but was interrupted by the COVID-19, is to bring both the data I can collect it from online data collection to offline, like on-site data collection, and also bring also the platform, not only online, but also make it offline and make it like a physical installation in the elephant castle, and then people, especially people who are not very good access to the digital technology, they can also being engaged through the physical installation. So I think it would be my further step. Yeah.
Amazing. Thank you very much, Mengpan. And so next question. With so many different media and processes used, what is unique to data visualization? This is addressed to anyone who wants to respond. Helen? Hello.
Hi, so I have to check whether you can hear me again, sorry. Yeah, okay. So I think the unique of data visualization, maybe we could draw on the data feminism theory. It's Ignacio and Kren in the article, they did mention that like the data visualization has the power to visualizing information and also without language. So as a data designer, when we after we analyze the data and we will find some insight, distinctive insight about the data, and we try to visualize with different medium to talk about our story. So I think this is the uniqueness of data visualization. Thank you again for the question.
Thanks again, Ellen, for answering these questions. Very interesting insights from you always. So next, what is something you took away from this project? And this is intended for anyone, any group, or any person who wants to respond. So any volunteers, anyone who has really come out of the project with something new that they have learned. Maybe I can answer quickly to this. saying, especially for myself, I found it very, not difficult, but challenging to be objective, as much as objectivity is not part of this word, but when it comes to data visualization, sometimes, especially for a topic like mine, I needed to look at from far away and avoid taking any stand, because with such a sensitive issue and culturally related, deeply rooted into behavior, social behaviors, and all these kind of things, my opinion wasn't really the first thing that I wanted to show. So I had to learn to step away from it. So that is something that I really learned from this project, to be aware that there is a plurality of voices and a plurality of thoughts and points of view. So mine or the individual ones are not always the only ones. And well, after this, I'm going to move on to the next question. So Ian asks, what are the main challenges designers face when creating data visualization? And he says, amazing work. Thank you. So anyone wants to answer this question?
Hi, maybe I can answer this question. Yeah, I'm Bing. So I think for me, the most challenges I faced during the design development is to find a suitable way or suitable format to do the data visualization. For my project, I did so many different visual experiments and finally pick music to convey data. As I can see, someone asked me that, do I have some knowledge about it? I don't have any knowledge about music before I did this project. And I knew there are a high peak and low peaks. So I just followed this rule to order my data. And I also, the reason why I chose music to do my final outcome, because I was inspired a book called 24/7, Late Capitalism and the End of Sleep. So career pointed that modern sleep includes the internal before sleep. So during this time, maybe people can hear the sound they can always ignore in our normal life, like the traffic, like the some dogs barks, something like that. So this is the thing we will always ignore. So when we use mobile devices, so I want to use music to communicate with the audience. When they are immersing it, maybe they can reflect the relationship between their own sleep helps and the mobile devices, like Heidegger said. And also it's quite important quote in my visual report is that not rejecting technology but perceiving danger. So yeah, thank you for the question. That's it.
Thank you for answering. Right. So let's pick another one. So what has made data visualization such an important field of design recently? Why now? So if anyone feels like answering to this very interesting question, very interesting. Do you have any thoughts on, I mean, it's a very complex answer, I think. Hello, Bella. Thank you for
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes. So the question is a very big question. So I would like to contribute some tiny thoughts of mine. Well, I think the fact that the audience, like the public, would like to read their own stories, would like to, you know, have the power of not only receiving the information and the data and the stories that, you know, the government or the the authorities that gave to you, but instead of that, to, you know, have the power to create their own story and to read their own story and have that subjectivity, I think that is something that we are really keen on doing for as in a field of data visualization. Yeah.
Thank you. I very much agree with that. And I think I would say the same. I would answer in a very similar way. So completely agree. And anyone wants to add to this? Any other thoughts? Or shall we move to the next one? Move on to the next one. So we have a question about tips. What is your tips on balancing data visualization and data insight? So I guess in this sense, tell me if I'm wrong, but I kind of interpret it this way. So kind of balancing, in a way, objectivity that could be the way that people interpret data visualization sometimes, with more personal stories, more personal related content. Hello, Bella.
For this question, I also think it is very important to have a balance on the readability of the data visualization and, you know, the content of it, and also like the design of it. Because if we're only like looking for the the readability and to show the context, to show the insight, we might lose the visualization, which might not attract the audience to read what you have done. And I think that's also something is very challenged, but I think we both, like all of us, work hard on balancing that. Yes.
Yes, absolutely. I would, I see there are so many great questions. Thank you so much for asking all these questions. We have another 10 minutes, more or less. So I'm gonna pick another few, and then I'm gonna move on to the ending this session. So this is very interesting. What are the most difficult or even most surprising parts of your subject matter? So I guess the topic of the project and why. Perhaps what did you learn or uncover that was surprising to you or posed a unique challenge in conceptualizing the final artifacts? So has anyone found any very big surprises while during their research process, or even hello, Sonia.
Hi. So for my project, I think the most challenging thing is that I need to meet the customers or users' demands with my how do I meet users' demands. So in my project, I do a lot of data physicalization things. So every time I did a prototype, I will test it with the user, but after several times, sculpture, I think, is always can't meet everybody's demands. So, so in the end, I just balanced my idea with the audience idea in the end. So, and yeah, and I think that's the most hardest part in the project. Thank you.
Yeah, I think that is common to almost anyone. I think that's something that we all have experienced in a way. So we have a question directed to the game character project. Cian says, my question is to projects with gender category. Did you consider about rethink binaries?
Hello.
Hello.
I have considered about this issue because my aim of this project is to make audience have self-reflection about gender binaries through this comic topic. And when I just analyze this data set, actually there is just only female and male category of superheroes. So it's difficult to recollecting some superheroes who are like no genders. But I want to let people to just create some superhero images without the consideration about gender, just to break this line, to think from the new perspective, like just focusing their power and some of other characteristics, and not just focus on this gender issues. So that's my answer.
Thank you, Hidden. And all right. So maybe last question or one of the last. What advice do you have in balancing data art and data journalism techniques so that your audience quickly understands the data and underlying message? So is it a matter of making sure our message is already, it is immediate, but also it is not too simplified, I guess. Does anyone want to add to this? Hello, Beth.
Hi. So first is just to test, a lot, have a lot of prototypes and, you know, show it to the people that don't know your project. So they will start from a very fresh point where they don't know your project. So they'll be like, oh, what is this or what is that? And then you can see the effect of your data visualization on whether it is it is being effective or it is clear. Another thing, I think data visualization is, or like I think design is quite interesting, is that it kind of acquire like logic in designing and, you know, and thinking and even research. So I think it is very useful to use something like mind map or stakeholder maps, you know, just tree testing, and use the logic to kind of map your thoughts and your research out, and also kind of your intentions on how you're gonna layer your visualization and your categories, your latch and all of that. And I think it really helps with you know, balancing the data visualization and the message. Yes.
Thank you. Thank you for your input. And I'm gonna quickly answer to a question that is directed to me, that in a way I've already answered to without knowing. So I kind of answered to the second part, what was the most challenging part of this project. I wanted just to say, in response to how did you print the garment, I tried many different things, like iteration process, but in the end, I designed the, let's say, the data art, or anyway, the design on, you know, Illustrator, any on our softwares, and then I sent it out to print. There are some very great services out there. Yeah, I hope this answers the question. To wrap up, probably the last question we have, we can answer. What is next for you all, for one of you in particular? What do you wanna do? Work, interns, PhD, and also, I might join it with another question. If you were to ask a new research question based on your research, what would that be? So questions about moving forward. If you were to look at your project again, how would you reframe it and what you want to do next? That is a tough question, isn't it? Hello, Ellen.
Hi, thank you for this question. Yeah, it's quite challenging, but I think like throughout of doing my final project, I've learned that because my project is about data surveillance, so I've designed a smart home system in the future to talk about this issue. But by doing the testing and prototyping process, and I find out that maybe different people will have other point of view towards my issue. Maybe they think those smart devices is really benefit for their quality of life. So maybe about Internet of Things, about this topic, some people will think that it's a threat to them, but some people will think it's a very beneficial thing. So moving on to the next, I think maybe I could further get a questionnaire or get an interview with more more members of public, and then reshape my project. And I think I could also invite some other designer or other people with different skill set to collaborate together and to reshape my project to a better way. Thank you.
Thank you, Ellen, for sharing. And I'm afraid that was our last question that we were able to answer. So thanks again for all these great questions.
Hello, everyone. I'm Mongfan again.
and I'm the last host. I know there are still many questions that are very good, but we don't have time to answer because the time really flies so fast and we have to quit a day now. And thank you all to coming and everyone, and thank you all everyone to being here with us today and asking so many questions. And thank you to other graduates who have participated in this event. On behalf of all the students, I would like to give a special thank you to our tutors, Henrietta, Ian, Lynn, and Emily, who have guided us throughout this journey. We would also like to thank the AVA team, Thomas, Maureen, and Nana, who are behind the scenes supporting this event to make it possible. This event was presented by MA Data Visualisation graduates, a course of the London College of Communication. Only a selection of projects was shown today, so feel free to browse through every student's work after this event by visiting our digital showcase. There are more than today's showcase on the website. So thank you all for taking part. Wish you a good day, good morning, good afternoon, and good night. You may now leave this session.